Okay, thank you. So I want to talk about Liouville theory today. And before that, I have my own announcements. So if someone still wants to do exercises, although there are no more tutorials for these lectures, you can ask, of course, me or the tutors for hints, or you can ask me even for written solutions. Then I'm going to skip the minimal models for lack of time. I mean the D-series minimal models, but this is in the notes. I'm going directly to Liouville theory. So let's define Liouville theory. So Liouville theory for any central charge, any complex central charge, Liouville theory is the conformal field theory whose spectrum is the following. So I'm going to write the spectrum, the exact spectrum. You may be puzzled that I'm starting essentially by the solution or by the answer, but you should view this spectrum as an ansatz, and I'll give arguments why this ansatz is very plausible, and then of course it has to be checked. So the spectrum will be an integral over the momentum over imaginary values of a Verma module on the left times a Verma module on the right. Okay, so why am I taking this particular spectrum? I want first a theory with a continuous spectrum. So I want a continuum of representation. I mean, that's the basic assumption. But then I still have to obey some axioms. In particular, the conformal dimensions should be bounded from below. Now, let's specialize to real central charge. And then I'm assuming, because it looks reasonable, that the conformal dimensions must also be real in this case. But we know from the study of the fusion rules that the good variable is not the conformal dimension, but it is the momentum p. So what values of the momentum correspond to real dimensions? Well, p should be real or pure imaginary. Now, if I'm taking real momentums, if I'm taking large real momentums, the dimension becomes infinitely negative and not bounded from below. So I need to restrict to momentum such that I have a bound below the dimensions. And the natural bound, of course, is zero. So that's why I'm only taking momentums here that are pure imaginary. And I'm also restricting to positive numbers because we have this symmetry p goes to minus p, which doesn't change the dimension. So I want each representation here to appear just once. Okay. Then, this definition is not complete. I'm going to make a few more assumptions. I'm assuming that Liouville theory is that correlation functions are smooth functions of B, of P and B, of momentums and B. And by smooth, essentially, I mean analytic. Well, there can be poles, there can be singularities, but essentially it means analytic. Of course, I'm assuming analytic functions of P and B, not of the central charge and of delta, again, because we know that these are the natural variables. Okay, so now, the definition is a definition only if you accept that this theory exists actually, and also that it is unique. And that's what we will try to prove. So, any questions?
What about C not in R? So,
Yes, so I have an argument for real central charge, and I'm just assuming, well, by analyticity, actually, that the spectrum is the same for all central charges. Okay, so let's try to study the correlation functions of UVL theory, and to, in particular, to examine crossing symmetry. So let's start with the two-point function. So VP1, VP2. Well, I have, of course, a delta function of P1 minus P2 by conformal symmetry. And I could stop there and normalize the fields so that the coefficient would be 1 here to make things simple. But I won't do that. I will allow some coefficient B of P1 because if I'm normalizing fields to 1, I would get non-analytic correlation functions later. So let's allow an arbitrary coefficient here. Well, I'm not writing the dependence on Z because it's universal, it's determined by symmetry. So let's adopt notations where we don't have dependence on Z. So in this notation, well, the three-point function reduces to a three-point structure constant. And the operator product expansion is as follows. So integral over momentums of what? Well, of some primary fields, VP plus descendants, with the coefficient C, P1, P2, P. Well, does this look correct? Well, in essence, I mean, in principle, it's correct essentially because of the general remark that the OPE coefficient here is the same as the three-point structure constant. But technically, to derive that remark, we had to assume the two-point function was 1. And now that the two-point function is no longer 1, I have to divide by the two-point function, B of P. So these are schematically the two three-point and three-point functions and the operator product expansion in UVL theory. Yes? Yes, well, it's because we know that fusion rules get simpler if you write them in terms of P and B. So for example, we had the fusion rule of degenerate representation with a Verma module, and we got a sum of two Verma modules, VP plus or minus B over 2. So if you rewrite that in terms of delta and C, well, it becomes ugly. Okay, so now we should solve crossing symmetry for UVL theory. But if you remember, the crossing symmetry equation, well, is involves the sum over the spectrum. So typically, a sum over S-channel fields, C, C, and the conformal block, is equal to a sum over T-channel fields, then structure constants and conformal blocks. Now, in our case, since we have a continuous spectrum, this sum becomes, well, an integral over P, over our spectrum. And here an integral again. So this equation is quite intractable. And it becomes more tractable if one of the fields is a degenerate field. So our problem a priori is that we don't have any degenerate fields in this spectrum. We just have Verma modules. Well, so let's introduce an axiom. Degenerate fields exist. So by existing, I really don't mean that they are in the spectrum. They are not. And in particular, if I'm decomposing a four-point function, I don't have to sum over these degenerate fields. By existing, I just mean that it makes sense to consider correlation functions with degenerate fields and that these correlation functions will obey all the usual axioms and in particular crossing symmetry. So it's a very non-trivial axiom. It's not obvious why it should be true, but we will assume it and see what are the consequences. By assuming it also, we recover the degenerate field V11, which corresponds to the identity module. So for those who were worried that the identity was not in the spectrum, well, the identity is present as a kind of unphysical field in this model. Okay, so now if degenerate fields exist, yes? Yes, so question, why is historical or other motivation for the existence of degenerate fields? So I'm not following at all a historical approach. I mean, historically, people started with Lagrangian formulation, and they derived the three-point structure constant, Dornotos and Mlechikov in 1995, using this path integral calculation. And at the same time, it was realized by Teschner that you could also derive it using degenerate fields. So in this path integral approach, actually you can get degenerate fields by analytic continuation of the fields, of the physical fields. So if you take your field VP with some momentum P, but then you send the momentum to some degenerate momentum, well, you'll get a degenerate field, and you can see if you take the limit of the operator product expansion, for example, that you would recover the operator product expansion of a degenerate field.
So the problem is that the degenerate momentum is only real instead of being purely imaginary.
Yeah, right. So the degenerate momentum, well, to take this limit, I have to go outside my spectrum. Basically, I have to use this assumption that I have analyticity in momentums. But that's not even what I want to do. I mean, I think it's better to just assume that degenerate fields exist because, well, that would work. That works for central charges, for generic central charges, but this actually is wrong for central charges less than one. So I think I just assume degenerate fields exist and look at consequences. So if degenerate fields exist, then they obey in particular they have operator product expansions. So let's write an operator product expansion of a degenerate field with a generic field, VP. And well, according to the fusion rules of degenerate fields, we should have VP plus or minus B over 2 with some coefficients, which now I denote C plus or minus of P. So I'm again making use of analyticity, because if P is pure imaginary, in general, P plus or minus B over 2 is no longer in the spectrum. So nevertheless, if correlation functions are analytic in P, then this still makes sense. No, B is complex. Yeah, generic complex number. You see the C is a generic complex central charge, and B is, it should not be zero, but okay. Okay, so then now that we have degenerate fields, we have computed four-point functions involving degenerate fields. So let's look at that again. So let's consider a four-point function with a degenerate field 2, 1, some field of momentum P1, P2, P3. And here I can have the two values of the momentum in this channel, P plus epsilon B over 2. So in particular, this is a diagram for S-channel conformal block. And I can decompose the four-point function V21 of Z, VP1 of 0, VP2 of infinity, VP3 of 1, as a sum of such blocks with some coefficients, which I called previously Cs plus minus. But now it becomes time to write what these coefficients are. Because, I mean, these coefficients, well, in general, in this four-point function decompositions, these coefficients should be product of two structure constants. So in this particular case, these coefficients are obtained by doing the operator product expansion of this field, the degenerate field with the field of momentum P1. And therefore, we have C plus or minus equals this big C plus or minus of P1. So the OP coefficients that I introduced here, And then what's left is a three-point structure constant for one field of momentum now, P1 plus epsilon B over 2. So P1 plus epsilon, well, now it's this epsilon is B plus or minus, P2, P3. So, sorry, no, I don't have a B in the denominator because actually that's a good point. But because I just defined these coefficients as OPE coefficients. So indeed, if you wanted to write this as a three-point structure constant, you would have this B in the denominator. Okay, so I'm quite happy with this formula because although I introduced a degenerate field, I'm still having here a three-point structure constant for generic momentums, I mean momentums that are not degenerate. So I can still get constraints on this three-point structure constant, even though I introduced a degenerate field. And what constraints do I get? Well, as a consequence of single-valuedness of this correlation function, we obtained an equation for the ratio of C plus S over C minus S. And let me remind you that this ratio was given by, well, F minus plus F minus minus over F plus minus F plus plus, where F is the fusing matrix that relates S channel with T channel conformal blocks. So now it's time to rewrite this equation more explicitly. So on the left-hand side, I'll use these expressions, and on the right-hand side, I'll use the explicit expressions for this fusing matrix, which actually is written in terms of gamma functions. So on the left-hand side, we have C plus of P1, CP1 plus B over 2, P2, P3, over C minus of P1, CP1 minus B over 2, P2, P3, equals, well, the right-hand side is a gamma, so I'll define this small gamma of 2BP1, gamma of 1 plus 2BP1, a product now of four gamma functions, gamma of 1/2 minus BP1, plus or minus BP2, plus or minus BP3. And this small gamma is just the Euler gamma function of x divided by gamma at 1 minus x. So the right-hand side comes from explicitly evaluating these F matrices. So F matrices, if you want, are essentially the coefficients that relate hypergeometric functions at some value z to, now I have too many Fs. So let hypergeometric function be the 2F1. So as a combination of hypergeometric functions at 1 minus z, and here you have these coefficients F, so this F matrices, yeah. And they are just they depend on the P1, P2, P3, so, well, we get a function of P1, P2, P3. Yeah. Are there other questions? Okay, so then, in principle, we're quite happy to have this equation for the three-point structure constant, but it involves some, let's say, unphysical or auxiliary objects, these OPE coefficients, C plus or C minus, which we'd rather be get rid of. So to be rid of them, what we could do is to consider another four-point function with two degenerate fields this time. So if I put a degenerate field here, and then let's say P here and P there, well, again, in the S channel, I can have P plus or minus B over 2. But the equation I will get, well, this time will involve, will be, well, let's just write it. Let's say we get C plus of P squared B of P plus B over 2 over C minus of P squared B of P minus B over 2 equals gamma of 2BP over gamma of minus 2BP, gamma of minus B squared minus 2BP, gamma over minus B squared plus 2BP. So essentially, yes? Yes, so why do I consider this particular four-point function? So I want to constrain my coefficients C plus and C minus. So basically, if I consider this four-point function, the coefficients here, the small c's in its decomposition, will just be a combination like that of C plus with B. So I'm happy to get B because this is, if you want, a physical quantity. It's the two-point structure constant. And therefore, by doing that, we get a relation between this two-point structure constant and the C plus or C minus. So this equation, if you want, is a kind of special case of this one, where I have, in particular, in the right-hand side here, this right-hand side with gamma function is just a special case of this right-hand side, where you have replaced the momentums like this P2 and P3 by P again and by P21 here. So I can write it like that. P2 equals P1 equals P, and you write P2, P3 equals P21. Okay. Okay, so now, another question? Yes? Sorry, why does B appear? Why is the two-point structure constant here appearing? Yes, well, again, it's because here, I mean, to write this this coefficient, I need essentially an OP coefficient and a three-point function. But if you want, the three-point function that I would need in this particular case is a VP plus or minus B, let's say VP plus B over 2, VP, V21. So that should appear. I mean, this, if you want, this CS plus should be C plus of P times this structure constant, which is C plus B over 2, P, and 2-1, if you want. But then, in this theory, we have a relation between this three-point structure constant and the OP coefficient. So if you insert the OP here, you get sum of plus minus. So I'm doing this OP, C plus minus of P, V P plus minus B over 2, VP plus B over 2. Right? So then by conformal symmetry, I must have the same dimension, so I must have a plus here. So I get the minus term vanishes, and I get C plus of P, B of P plus B over 2, so the two-point function here. Yeah, and that's why if I insert this here, now I'm getting this C plus squared times B of P over 2. Other questions? Okay, so now we have these equations, which we could call shift equations for the three-point structure constant C. So because they tell you how it behaves when P1 is shifted by B, essentially. Now we have to solve these shift equations. Well, actually, we don't just have this shift equation. We have another shift equation, because if we replace the field V21 with V12, it's just the same as in all these equations, replacing B with 1 over B. So we have two shift equations, which tell us how what happens when the structure constant is shifted by B or by 1 over b. So here I'm writing b and 1 over b in the complex plane of momentums, if you want. In general, for general complex values, there are just two complex vectors. Now, there are special cases. So that would be what I call B complex or C complex, so the generic case. But there are cases when these two vectors are aligned. So the first case would be B squared real and even positive. So that corresponds to C larger than 25. In this case, B and 1 over B are both real, so they are aligned on the real line. On the other hand, if I have a negative B squared, and that would be C less than 1, they are also aligned, but on the imaginary axis. Now what we would like is a special function, a function that gives us gamma functions when its argument is shifted by b. So we are looking for a function that I will call epsilon. Well, we don't yet know if it exists, but such that epsilon of x plus b over epsilon of x should be gamma of bx. And since we will also have this dual equation, we need that the same function epsilon, when its argument is shifted by 1 over b, produces gamma of 1 over b x. So if we have these functions, we have a chance of solving our shift equation for the three-point structure constant. Now, do these functions exist? I mean, does anyone think that there are such functions? I mean, who thinks this function epsilon b exists? And who thinks it does not exist? Oh, you're not skeptical enough, I think. Nobody thinks it does not exist, and still, actually, technically, it does not exist. But okay, those who said it exists are right in principle, because essentially it exists. However, I mean, the problem is that I have two shift equations, and there is some compatibility condition. So if I do a shift by b here and by 1 over b here, and then I do another shift by b and another shift by 1 over b, I should get the same result. So this right-hand side should be such that this compatibility is obeyed. And actually, it doesn't work. But it can be made to work by adding some very simple factors, 2 to the minus 2 to the b to the 1 minus 2bx, and b to the minus 1 plus 2b minus 1x. So now, with these factors, the two equations are compatible, so we have a chance of finding its solution. And actually, its solution is even unique, because if b is real, these two periods, b and 1 over b, are aligned. And assuming b squared is not rational, and assuming my function epsilon b is continuous, then it has to be unique. So that's actually called the Liouville theorem, although it was not derived with Liouville theory in mind. Okay, and then, well, it's unique for a real B, but since we are requiring analyticity in B, it will be unique everywhere. Up to a constant factor, okay. So let's write this function. This function is essentially an infinite product from 1 to infinity of two integers m and n of f of q over 2 minus x over q over 2 plus mb plus nb minus 1, where f of x is 1 minus x squared exponential x squared. Yes? Yes. Yes, so lack of continuity means that these equations could have more solutions. And, well, it could make Liouville theory not unique.
Okay, but is this in contradiction with single-variedness of correlation functions or this kind of stuff?
Yeah, so the question is whether dropping the continuity or even an LST assumption would contradict anything, and the answer is no. And actually, for C less than 1, we will find that not only there is a Liouville theory for any such value of the central charge, but there exists a similar conformal field theory with the same spectrum, but with different structure constants which are not continuous. Well, it exists provided actually B squared is rational. And strictly negative. So then you have an alternative CFT with the same spectrum and non-analytic correlation functions. Okay, so this alternative CFT, well, it was first discovered at C in the case C equals 1, where it's called Runkel-Watts theory. Well, guess you found it. And also then it was generalized to any C of the type, any B squared. So that's a generalization. Okay, so really the assumption of nullity is crucial for the uniqueness of Liouville theory. So, other questions? Okay, so let's come back to this function epsilon b. So epsilon b, is a relatively simple function in the sense that if you look at this function, well, the exponential factor is just here to make this infinite product converge, so it's really not important. What's important is this 1 minus x squared, which has two poles. So essentially, this function tells you that we have poles for infinitely many values of x, and the poles are given essentially by these numbers. So it's an analytic function, a completely analytic function. It has many, when I say poles, I mean zeros, actually, sorry. So it's an analytic function with many zeros, infinitely many zeros. And it's also base epsilon b of x equals epsilon b of q minus x. And the last exercise of the lecture notes is to show that indeed this function obeys this kind of shift equations. Well, it's not very difficult to see that you have some kind of gamma function on the right-hand side. What's more difficult is to really get the precise formulas. Yes?
Can you explain again why you're doing this and how it solves the...
Yes, so here I have a shift equation where on the right-hand side I have combinations of gamma functions. So if you want, the shift equation is of the type C of P1 plus B over C P1 equals some gamma functions. That's a schematic rewriting of my shift equation. So to solve this kind of equation, I need a function that has similar properties like that. Yeah. So other questions? Okay. So now let's use this special function to actually solve the shift equations. So to solve the shift equations, well, really, I'm starting by the difficult part. The difficult part are the factors that depend on P1, P2, and P3. I mean, really, that's what we should take care of in priority. So let's write an ansatz, CP1, P2, P3.
equals, well, some normalization factor times, well, some again, some normalization factors that depend on P1, P2, and P3, but factorized. And then something that will take care of this gamma depending on all momentums. And this something is a product over two signs of epsilon b of q over 2 minus p1 plus or minus p2 plus or minus p3. So the claim is that if I take the ratio of this c with a shifted p1 over c with a shifted in the other direction, I will essentially recover all my gamma factors that depend on P1, P2, and P3. Now, are you happy with this, let's say, ansatz for a solution? Well, you may be a bit worried that it doesn't look terribly symmetric on the permutations of the three momentums. I should have permutation symmetry, of course, in this three-point function, but permutation symmetry is actually there thanks to a property of the epsilon function, which I'm rewriting here. Epsilon b of x is epsilon b of q minus x. So actually, it is permutation symmetric. So it's a plausible ansatz. So now if we insert it into our shift equation for c here, well, all the dependence on the three momentums will disappear and we'll be left with an equation for C plus N of P, P plus B over 2 over C minus N of P minus B over 2. And that will be essentially the combinations of gamma functions which we had there, gamma of 2BP, gamma of 1 plus 2BP, and if we do it correctly, we should find some factor b to the 8bp also. So now, okay, so at least we have indeed taken care of these non-trivial factors, and we are left with just factors that depend on one momentum. So we have this equation, and we had also this equation. So by using these equations, we can eliminate C plus and C minus, our auxiliary quantities. And we will be left with an equation for, well, for what? For N squared B minus 1 for this particular combination. I mean, we square this equation and combine it with the other equation. We will be able to determine essentially N squared B minus 1. And actually, the answer is product epsilon b of plus or minus 2p. Now, yeah, we have determined n squared b minus 1, but we have no hope of determining independently n squared and b. And that's because we have a freedom of renormalizing our fields. So the field vp was defined as a primary field of the Virasoro algebra, but if I'm putting some factor lambda of p, well, it remains a primary field. So it is defined only modulo such factors. And under such a renormalization, we would have b of p goes to lambda squared b of p, and n of p goes to lambda n of p. So n squared b minus 1 is really the combination that is invariant under these renormalizations. So that's the only thing we can hope to actually determine. And then you're actually free to choose your normalization. So which normalization would we want to choose? Well, we could choose n equals 1. It looks pretty simple. We could choose b equals 1. Well, can we really choose b equals 1? So if we set b equals 1 here, n squared equals this analytic function. I mean, this has simple zeros. We take a square root of a function with simple zeros, we get a non-analyticity. So we don't want b equals 1. That's why, actually, we didn't set b equals to 1 from the very beginning. But, well, okay. Actually, if we specialize to minimal models, for example, we could have b equals 1, because in minimal models, there is no continuous parameter, so we don't care about having square roots. There is a special choice, which is n of p equals epsilon b of 2p. And if you choose this normalization, then your formula here for the three-point structure constant becomes the DOZZ formula for Dornoto, Zamolodchikov, Zamolodchikov. So it corresponds to the particular normalization that comes out of your functional integral definition of Liouville theory. So if you define your field VP as e to the 2BP, e to the 2, q over 2 plus minus p phi, where phi is your boson, if you define Liouville theory from the Lagrangian d phi d bar phi plus mu e to the 2B phi, and if you do the functional integral, well, you will recover the three-point function with this particular normalization. Okay, but in principle, from the bootstrap point of view, any normalization is okay.
Sorry,
yes?
The box,
so, yes, ah, sorry. So the 8BP was excluded from the box, which is not good. So this prefactor is here because of the prefactors we had in the definition of the epsilon function. So over there, you have a shift equation for epsilon function. And when you do a shift, you get this b to the 1 minus 2bx prefactors. And so it is these factors which eventually give you such factors. Yeah. OK. So now, did we solve already Liouville theory for all values of the central charge? Well, not quite, because this epsilon b function is actually defined for b, for any b squared that is not negative, that is not real negative. You can see actually that the product formula, which defines this epsilon function over there, will diverge if b squared is real negative. Because essentially, you have zeros, and these zeros will not go to infinity as the product indices M and N increase, but they will remain, some of them will always remain at finite distance, so that makes your product diverge. However, of course, from the structure of the shift equations, there should also exist a unique solution in this regime. So in this regime, b squared, now b squared real negative. So the unique solution is, what I will call epsilon hat b, and it can be rewritten in terms of epsilon b as 1 over epsilon ib of ib minus ix. So that is the solution, the unique solution of the same equations, but now for a negative b squared. And if you replace in this in the three-point structure constant, if you replace epsilon by epsilon hat, you get a c hat. And this c hat is a solution, of course, and it's well defined. Well, now it's defined except if b squared is positive. Yes. This is just because I'm lazy. I don't want to rewrite another special function. I can reuse this special function. I mean, this is just an exercise, I would say. It's not completely obvious, indeed, that, that it works. Yeah. Yes? Yeah, so the question is whether epsilon hat is the analytic continuation of the original epsilon, and the answer is no. The original epsilon does not have a limit when b squared goes to this half line, so it's a different function. And if you compare them at a generic value of the central charge, where both of them are defined, well, they are different. They differ by, well, they differ by an elliptic function, because an elliptic function, meaning a function that is periodic with periods B and 1 over B. So, well, the statement now, so that's the definition of an elliptic function. And the statement is that for B squared not real, so you have an epsilon B, and you have also an epsilon hat B. Both of them are well defined. Both of them obey the same shift equations, so their ratio has to be an elliptic function. So let me summarize the situation. We have, let's say, generic central charge. We could have a central charge less than 1, that's b squared strictly negative. Central charge greater than 25, b squared strictly positive. And here we have just the unique solution. Let's say C hat. Here we have the unique solution C, and here we have C and C hat, two solutions. So looks bad for the uniqueness of Liouville theory. But the point is that we have just studied crossing symmetry in the presence of degenerate fields. But for Liouville theory to be consistent, we would need crossing symmetry for generic four-point functions, so four-point functions involving four arbitrary momentums, P1, P2, P3, P4. So do we have crossing symmetry for this four-point function? Well, probably if Liouville theory exists, we should have crossing symmetry for C more than 25 and also for C less than 1. The question is whether by analyticity we can get crossing symmetry for other values of a central charge. So we have to study the analytic properties, not just of the three-point structure constant, but also of the four-point function. So the four-point function, which is, well, product VPI of ZI, which is integral over the spectrum, dp, some structure constants, so CP, P1, P2, CP, P3, P4, over B of P, times the S-channel conformal block. And if you are, if you want the solution C hat, well, you just replace the C by C hat. So the question is whether this expression now is analytic as a function of the central charge. And to investigate this, what we should do is to look at the analytic properties of the integrand, and in particular its poles, because this integrand has poles. And actually, the poles that matter are the poles of the conformal block. So where are the poles of the conformal block? So we had an expression already for the conformal block, for the S-channel conformal block. That was z to the delta minus delta 1 minus delta 2, 1 plus delta plus delta 1 minus delta 2, delta plus delta 4 minus delta 3 over 2 delta z plus corrections. And already in this first order expansion, we see a pole appearing where delta equals 0. And it's not a coincidence, but delta equals 0 is the dimension, is a degenerate dimension of the representations that have a null vector at level 1. And actually, the structure is the same at higher levels. So the statement is that f delta s of z has a simple pole for Well, actually, we're interested in the dependence on P, but that's equivalent. So for P equals P RS, which was, if you remember, 1 half BR plus B minus 1 S. And that's for RS positive integers. OK, any questions on this? Yes? So the question is whether you're asking the question of the existence of Liouville theory and whether I can easily see it from the bootstrap approach. Because in the path integral, actually, you essentially start with the existence, but then you have to work out all the properties. And the bootstrap approach is kind of the reverse. You start with the properties, but at the end, you should prove that it exists. Well, the question of the existence really boils down to checking this crossing symmetry equation. So we should check that this S-channel decomposition is the same as the T-channel decomposition, which I'm not writing explicitly. Well, there is a formal proof by Teschner of this equality. And you can also do a numerical proof. You can put this on a computer, and you check it to 10 or 15 digits. And, well, that's what I did. But if you're not happy, you can probably make it to 100 digits with more effort. So barring a surprise, it's pretty convincing, I think. But we are not yet quite there. I mean, yes, we are there for C more than 25. I mean, for C more than 25, all we have to do is this numerical proof. But now we still have the question of analytic continuation and analyticity of this four-point function. And for that, we look at the poles of the integrand, and in particular of the conformal blocks, and compare their position with the integration line here, so the imaginary line. So let's draw the complex plane for the momentum P. So that's zero. So integration line. Well, actually, I can say that the line runs from minus infinity to plus infinity. I mean, I have this symmetry P goes to minus P. So originally, I had a half line, but it's equivalent to write the full line with a factor 1 half. And then where are these poles, P, R, S? Well, if B is positive, for example, the poles P, R, S are just on the real line somewhere. So that's for B, B squared positive. Now, if B becomes complex, this half line of poles becomes a kind of wedge. Well, the poles are always discrete, but they are discrete in this way. They are discrete on some lattice like that. And then we have the same lattice there. So that's for generic B squared. And then if B squared becomes negative, well, that means B is pure imaginary, and the poles are just there. Well, so, oops, I avoided a big problem by writing my integration line not just on the imaginary line, but I shifted it a bit, so that now I'm avoiding the poles, because otherwise I would have a big problem. So that's essentially how the theory is defined for C less than 1. You have to shift the integration line to avoid the poles. Now what happens when I try to analytically continue in B itself? Well, if I start from the case B squared positive and I analytically continue, nothing much happened because the poles are still away from the integration line. So therefore, we can go from here to there by analytic continuation. But if I want to reach B squared negative, basically, I have to take these lattices of poles and to put them on the imaginary axis. And in this process, obviously, all these poles will have to cross the integration line. And therefore, this limit is not analytic at all. So therefore, I can't. There is a separation here between generic complex C and C less than 1. And therefore, this C hat, well, it's a solution of the shift equations for C less than 1, but it's not a solution of this more general crossing symmetry equation. So then we recover a unique Liouville theory, which can be, well, at least numerically proved to be to exist. And the structure constant is C for generic complex central charge. It's big C, but it becomes C hat for C less than 1. And C less than 1 is interesting because it has applications to statistical physics, for example. OK, thank you.